we start. So thank you all for coming. This is our first Gertrude Bell Lunchtime Seminar. So I don't know if you know or remember from the little blurb that we sent around, but in Special Collections we have the Gertrude Bell Archive. And we are currently in the middle of a project, which is titled Gertrude Bell and the Kingdom of Iraq at 100. So the project is, okay, are you finished?
Yep.
Oh, right. Cool. I'll just put the little intro slide. So the project is based around cataloguing and re-digitising the archive. So we've had this archive for a long time, most of it since 1926, since she died. There are a lot of diaries, letters and photographs, so that's like the main bulk of the archive, but there's also reports and memoranda and other little pieces that, like, we've got her book collection as well, and other little pieces that have come in over the years and kind of different deposits. So originally we got all the letters from Bell to her family, and then we got like extra bits from Bell to other people and other people to Bell, just as people kind of donated them and realised that it was maybe we are the right place to have these donations if people had them lying about or they got them into their institution. So the material is available online on our Gertrude Bell website. It's transcribed, the letters, the diaries, and the photographs are digitised, but they were digitised quite a while ago, so scans aren't great. And part of this project is re-digitising them so that we, as Rory will show you later on when he shows you his presentation, there are beautiful, beautiful images that she took. All across the Middle East and in Europe as well, and alongside digitising the photographs, we're also going to be digitising the letters and the diaries. So although the transcriptions are available, I know that people often, I think that people often think about archives that they're coming to see the content, but seeing the physical object, even if you're not handling it, even if you're not able to physically handle it, seeing the object is a totally different experience. And I'm going to assume that you all kind of know who Gertrude Bell is. Would anyone like me to give a quick description? I'm happy to do that. No? Okay, good.
Physical description.
No, just general description. Just because I am aware that we might run over a little bit, so I didn't want to kind of waste too much time. But basically, Bell was instrumental in the creation of the country, Kingdom of Iraq in 1921. She was born in County Durham in Washington, so she is local. She was the granddaughter of Isaac William Bell, who was a very famous industrialist, and her dad was also an industrialist too. They were a very well-off family, a lot of society connections. She frequently mentions these in her letters and diaries, which is really interesting and also a lot of work, because then you have to work out who all those people are. And she went travelling, partially, I guess, probably all because of the money. You know, she was very privileged, she was able to do that, but she also had a vested interest. She was really interested in seeing new places, she was really interested in archaeology, and that privilege that she had allowed her, like, you know, opened the doors for her to go to different places. So one of her like big milestones, at least in my head, is when she visited Frank Lassels, who was, I believe, her uncle, and he was at the time an ambassador, and he was in Persia, in Tehran, and she writes in her letters and diaries how excited she is to go and see him, and she really wants to go, and from then she starts kind of going to lots of different places in the Middle East. She was involved in the Arab Bureau in the First World War, a position that again kind of happened through who she knew and privilege, but also through the skills that she'd gained in her travels beforehand, which when she was just traveling for herself. So she created a lot of maps, learned a lot about the people that lived in the places that she went to, and that kind of diplomatic and strategic knowledge was, an invaluable resource for the British. So anyway, before I went off on that little explanation that no one really needed, I was talking about how handling and seeing the physical items, it just adds a whole other dimension to your interpretation of the archive. So my presentation, I usually do a big script and then totally disregard it because I get nervous. So this time I thought I would not do that, and I've just made a PowerPoint. So I was like, I'm going to pull some of the lovely things that I found. So sorry, I forgot to say, I'm a project archivist. So I'm cataloguing the archive, which means I get to go through everything. It's a big job. As I said, she talks about a lot of people in a lot of places, and I've got to kind of pull all that out with the help of my colleagues. But I also have the privilege of seeing all this stuff. And I actually started the job not knowing too much about Bell. So I've come into it really like objective. just was like, she was really important historically, and I'm kind of soaking everything else up. So for this PowerPoint, I thought I would just show you really nice things that I found that I thought were interesting, but I ended up kind of going down a rabbit hole of her diaries. So as I was looking through her diaries when I first started, I realised that she had pressed flowers in them, which was lovely, and I really didn't expect to see that, because some of the other diaries I'd seen had nothing. And then I discovered these, and I was like, oh, amazing. So I was going to put some of these in the PowerPoint, and then I started just looking at the entries that accompany the cuttings and the pressings. And I thought, it's just so interesting to track where she went and what she saw, and her, like, alongside her writing. So she's really famous. I'm going to shut that door, sorry. She's really famous for her political, diplomatic, archaeological, all that kind of like professional stuff. But she's also an amazing writer. So when I first started, I got one of her books, which was kind of difficult to read for me because I didn't have a knowledge of the geography. So I was like, okay, so she went here, but I don't really know where that is. But the writing is so evocative, and it's of its time, and it's really beautiful. And it's, so when I was putting this together, I thought, oh wow, do you know what? I'm just going to stick to the diaries because there's so much to look at. And it was really fun for me. So I hope it's fun for you to look at as well. So these are just a few. There are others that have cuttings. The bulk of the diaries don't, but these are some of them, but there are some that I wasn't able to fit in. So this is from her trip in 1894 in January, the 21st, when she was in Italy. So she kind of started off going around Europe and then progressed further afield. And this is her cutting dated. Oh, February! Oh, that's my mistake, sorry, just ignore that, it's actually February. So she says, up to Fiesole, lunched in the tram and eat oranges in the Roman Theatre, which is here. Such a dear little place with rows of broken seats looking out onto a hillside covered with olives and cypresses. Climbed down the hillside, through valley gardens and olive groves, past Lander's villa to San Domenico, great scramble, daffodils in all the gardens. Now she doesn't say what flower this is, she just says where she's found it. But after a little bit of, actually in fact, you know, it was in the transcription on the website, someone who transcribed them was able to identify the flower, thankfully. I'm not a flower expert, but they identified it as an anemone. Anemone, yeah, I said that right. And I looked up to see what ones are most common in that place. And this is the anemone coronaria, the poppy anemone, which is native to the Mediterranean region. And this is where she was, where she ate her oranges and sat and looked out onto the hillside covered with olives and cypress trees. So I just thought, that's so evocative and lovely. And you can really just go on her journey with her through her diaries. And obviously the item adds so much. So on the transcription, it just says square brackets, pressed anemone. But actually seeing it, it's just such a wonderful surprise when you turn the page. And it's still got her little pins in it, which is a little bit of a conservation issue. So I was like, oh no, I'm scared about taking the pins out. So I've ordered some special preservation quality. What are they called? They're the pins that you basically use if you're pinning butterflies. I can't remember the name now. Etymological pins. So I haven't done that yet, but if there was no way to swap the pins, I would probably leave them, because they're such a evocative, lovely part of the original object. And actually, they're quite good condition. Seen a lot worse metal. There's not really any rusting. So this is all kind of part of the considerations when you're looking through as an archivist, and also keeping in mind that you want to preserve the integrity of the original object. Although I will say, have put acid free tissue paper on top of all of these, although you can't see it in these pictures, because as you'll see in a few slides time, they do make an impression on the other side. So this is Austria, moving on to August 1894, and her gentians, don't know if I'm saying that right, not a flower expert, but she describes her day. So she says, up the mountain, the Stanzer Joch, which is this mountain here, she reached the top about 11 and lunched. Came down pretty fast into the Inntal, which I was a bit confused. So I was trying to find out where this was. So I'm doing this as a bit of an amateur, which is why I really enjoy doing it. And I think that it's Rintal in Germany. So I think she crossed the border and then came to Schwarzbachlen, back in Austria in the Tyrol. She said it was very hot. I think she said like 80 degrees in the shade. And then thankfully she identifies it for us. So I found four kinds of gentians, and she's written this here. So she's like, next page. I couldn't find four specifically online. It's very hard to work out what colours. I'm guessing probably not blue, but blue really did come up when I was looking for it, because there's a specific alpine one, which is here, and then the spotted one, which it could be. So this is this, oh, sorry. this is this kind of like voyage of discovery, not quite knowing, that I really love about being an archivist. So Barbados, further afield, 1898. I think this was my favourite because it's a caterpillar. So when I first saw this, I was looking at the description. I think we looked at it, Kate, the first time you came. And I'll start with the first one. So Scarlet Cordia, a clustering flower growing on a tree, which is this one here. A yellow acacia looking thing, which is a quassia, and the long pod is medicinal. And I googled it, and it is indeed. It's homeopathically used to treat diabetes, ulcers, malaria, digestive problems, among other things. And then she talks about the frangipani, which she has put a little cutting off. So when I saw this, I was like, it has a marvellous caterpillar yellow and green. And I thought she meant like the yellow and green of a caterpillar was the colour of the flower. And then this, for months, what this? I was like, it doesn't really look yellow and green, but maybe it's just like age. And then I read it again for this presentation. And I was like, a finger long belonging to it. I was like, no, it's a caterpillar. So this is a caterpillar, and it is actually a frangipani caterpillar, Tetrio sphinx. This is what I think it is. It has to be. It's too much of a coincidence. And it is actually massive. So that was really interesting. And she also mentions the bearded tree, which is one of a ficus benjamini, which is a weeping fig tree. So I didn't mention earlier that she's really into nature. She's really into flowers. She, at one of her homes, I think it was Roundton Grange, she actually designed the garden, and she brought back a cutting of a tree from the Middle East. Unfortunately, right at the second, I can't remember where she brought it from, but it's still there. They planted it, and although the house is not a house any longer, I don't know if they demolished it, yeah. But there is a nursery there, and you can go and visit. It's called like Dark Star Gardens or something. And you got in touch with them. Sorry, I'm telling you. Sorry.
From Lebanon. It's a Lebanese.
Oh, thank you.
Sycamore, I think.
Yes. Oh, thank you. Just remembered as I was saying that it was you that got in touch. Perfect. So now we get to Japan in the same. What was it? The same year? Oh, sorry. Oh no, it's fine. I thought I put that in the wrong place, but no, this is March. The last one was January. So now she's in Japan. And this is kind of what I was referring to earlier about having cool inserts is all very well and good, but if they stay touching paper too long, this is what happens. So now that's okay, we've got some acid-free tissue paper on it. It's not bled through to the other side, but the decision as to how to deal with that, I wouldn't take that out. We wouldn't take that out, but we would take kind of every measure that we can just to protect the rest of the object. But I just think that's really interesting because it's not something I would have thought about until I worked with collections. I don't know what this is, unfortunately. She doesn't really say. Sometimes she says and sometimes she doesn't, but it's a really beautiful little woven souvenir, I suppose, from where she was. So she says, exquisite Shogun tombs, Ieyasu's temple, doves, cryptomedia avenues, which I looked up, and she says plural, but I think this is it. And if it's not it, it's very similar to what it would be. So this is a postcard from 1901. And a photograph from 1906 that I found online. They're not hers, unfortunately. G. Daiashi's temple with a praying wheel at the door, great columned Kongwanji temple, then to a tea house where we said our honourable insides were empty, sat on the mats and eat pickled vegetables, rice and broiled fish, sake, tea before and after, and pipes to follow. So I just thought it was very lovely. I wanted to show you all. Greece. I'm aware I'm running a little bit over, but that's okay. This is 1899, in April the 13th, and this is her flower that she's not unfortunately described it, but she does talk about all of the nature and all the sights that she's seen. So she says, off eight to Epidaurus, 3.5 hours drive, bare hills, tinkling flocks of goats and sheep, an occasional white-clad peasant, and the great walls of a Pelasgian fort crowning a hill. Poppies, anemones, hawthorn. So with the help of Rory, who knows all about archaeology, worked out that we think that she's talking about the Fort of Larissa, which is here, and it is indeed crowning a hill. And then she says, lunched in the great theatre at Epidaurus, a fine, great place holding 16,000 people, almost perfect. We experimented in the acoustics of it and found we could hear Papa perfectly from the top line of seats. And I don't know whether this is a poppy, I'm not sure what flower this is, unfortunately, but these are poppies, wild poppies growing in the theatre. And I just thought the last bit was my favourite, because that is what we all do, isn't it? If you're in a tunnel, you shout and you see how far your voice goes. So no matter how rich you are, no matter how much you're into archaeology, no matter how much you know about it, we all kind of do the same fun things when we're jaunting around. And this is the last one, but this is like my favourite, because look at it, it's just so lovely and it retains its colour. It's still, it's not as vibrant as it would have been, but it's still, you can still tell that it's something exotic and beautiful. And this is another example. She doesn't say what it is, but she just says where she's found it. So she's at the Taj Mahal. Similarly with the one from Fusil, she doesn't say what that is. We can only guess. Which was kind of part of the fun of putting this together, actually, was that I can't be 100% certain sometimes. But that's okay, because you still get an idea of the sights and the sounds and the smells and everything that she's experienced by looking into it. So she says, drove off to the Taj and saw it by sunset light. The gate itself is magnificent, the deep archways making such fine dark shadows. But the Taj looks lovely from the steps of the gateway. The garden's full of flowers and water and the dark red bougainvillea flowering. Hope I didn't pronounce that wrong. We went into a pavilion at the corner of the wall and watched the sunset glow onto the Taj and the long sweep of the Yamuna set with Hindu shrines. The tombstone with a soft warm light as if it were illuminated from within, and all the gardens smelt sweet of flowers and of water. I think this is the view. This is the Taj Mahal Mosque Pavilion, unless she is at another pavilion, but this is the one that I could find where you can see the Yamuna River and you can see the Taj Mahal. And I just loved the garden smelt sweet of flowers and of water, so evocative. And I think, I don't know again, but this is a ringneck parakeet, which is very common in India. And I was like, could it be? I feel like it could be, but she doesn't say. I assume she's just found it when she's been there and she's picked it up as a souvenir. But yeah, that's the end of my little presentation. I just wanted to give, I was going to do a general and then I just went into the diaries and I thought, oh, this is so much fun. So I hope you've enjoyed it. Oh, Rory's now on.
You were fine at the time because you had the introduction as well, didn't you?
Yes, right. I wasn't, see, this was me not going on a script. I think it was okay, to be honest.
Right, so when we find out how black and white deals with 70s lighting. Hello, I'm Rory. I'm the Northern Bridge placement student. So I'm a PhD student at Durham. And I'm working with the Gertrude Bell Archive at the moment with the digitization of the photos. So Graham Robson, who's the digitization assistant, that's official, has been taking all of, well, photos of the negatives and of the photo albums and redoing them for the website. So at the moment, we've currently got sort of preview photos, I suppose, aren't they? So I'm hoping that I can at least give a showcase of just the quality of the imagery that's now available to us. My PhD is on Palmyra, so hence the focus specifically on the site in Roman Syria. So yeah, I'm gonna give you, as a little bit like Valentina, kind of a whistle-stop tour of Palmyra. And the fun bit is that it's exactly 122 years to the day since she was there. Mm-hmm. So if we're celebrating an anniversary, we can at least celebrate that one. Right. There's going to be some dose of Gertrude Bell, as we'd expect. But I thought I'd start with this, which is basically that Palmyra is not Petra, appears to be Gertrude's summary of the place. So we've got a little discussion here in the first paragraph of her basically requesting some more funds off her father, Hugh, so that she can make this intrepid voyage into the desert. So she's basically traveling through Syria at this point, but of course it was the Ottoman Empire, so there's less kind of obvious borders. But she's after some military men basically to secure her travel, and she says, "I don't see that the Palmyra journey ought to be much more expensive than all the others. It seems I shan't have to take more than 3 soldiers at the outset." So as I'm sure, I know Mark's traveled a lot in the region, I'm sure you go around with 3 soldiers, don't you, all the time? So yeah, this is requesting from Hugh Bell, who's one of the wealthiest men in Britain at this point, for extra funds so that I can go to Palmyra. But of course, I probably will anyway. It's Gertrude's comment. So this is a little bit of the location of Palmyra. So where you can see why this represents such an intrepid adventure. It had only been rediscovered 200-300 years previously. So Bell's still in the first, well, no, mid-19th century, there's a bit of an explosion in travel to the region, but she's certainly still one of these handful of Westerners who would have been to the site at this stage. So this is just a little sense of kind of where it slots in geographically. And then, of course, she's actually only there for 2 full days. So we're going to kind of go through the 30-odd photos that we have of the site that she took. But realistically, she arrives very late on that May the 20th, so 122 years ago today. She spends the 21st doing pretty much everything. And then she's off to the Valley of the Tombs, those iconic tower tombs that we'll see soon. And then on the 23rd, she's off basically at crack of dawn. So it's a brief trip, but as ever, you're with your military troop, and you're obviously there at the Bedouin tribes people who have the kind of control over your visit to the ruins. So there would have been certain elements that were not necessarily in her control. So this would have been one of her first views of the ruins. So we can see obviously the Valley of the Tombs to the right, down towards the colonnade to the left. I've got a little section from the diaries and a little section from the letters that I wanted to read out. So this is on the day of her arrival. So at sunrise saw Palmyra far away, my horse and I very tired, walked from 5:30 to 6:30. Our road lay between two low ranges of hills like an avenue running up to Palmyra. We got to the bottom of the sloping bank of the cross range about 8 and soon found ourselves among the tower tombs, which we'd see over there in front of the tombs. We went down to the sulphur spring and watered our beasts, then rode on to a little temple on the other side of the ruins where I determined to camp. Got there at 10, I ate some bread and drank some milk, a very high wind scattering the sand over all I ate and drink. At 11:30, my tent was ready. At 12, I went to bed and slept till 2, then got up and had some tea. About 5, I walked down into the town, or rather into the Temple of the Sun, and strolled about, the little boys crowding round and everyone asking for backsheesh. The great columns peering out of the mud houses, the big west dorm and wall is new made, almost entirely of bits of column. The triumphal arch at the end of the street of columns is very elaborately carved. The side doors are double, the second lot twisting aside to the direction of the temple. The stone has weathered to a lovely yellow, which the sunset turns red almost. The desert lies beyond. One of the things I really enjoy about her diaries, and obviously lastly her letters, which we'll look at again in a minute, is that kind of almost gothic narrative that she gives to events. She has that kind of very much dramatic appeal. So this is obviously her first view. So if we're on the hill with the castle, looking right towards the Valley of the Tombs, you can see the oasis, which was the reason that Palmyra first developed as a city, really, because obviously we're in the middle of the Syrian steppe. So we have these palm groves, which are probably not unique, but certainly the reason that Palmyra became such a large civilization in kind of peaked around 2nd century AD during the Roman time. So we get a sense here of where, so she's starting up here. This is where the views are taken. So we can view right towards the Valley of the Tombs, which is where she'll eventually wander in and up to the top of the colonnade. And then looking down towards the Temple of Bel, which is where the Ottoman town was within the terminus of the temple there. So you get a sense of what, well, I still haven't worked out what beast this is. I feel it looks a bit like an armadillo, but you get a sense of sort of the shape of the ruins. And nowadays there's the new town up there towards the north. I want to say east. I'm not entirely sure what. Yeah, so we've got the ruins here anyway, as depicted centrally there. Permit me to give another, we start with two large sections of Gertrude Bell, but I feel like that was going to happen in a Gertrude Bell seminar series. So in the letters, we get here a sense of the wider expanse of the ruins of Palmyra and the sheer scale of what would have been a very large ancient city in this period. So again, we can see the palm groves over there behind the Temple of Bell. This is the Temple of Bell, the terminus where the town was situated, the iconic colonnade. You can't quite see the arch, but that would be the arch. This is the Temple of Bel Shemin, which is where she sets up her camp, as we'll see in a minute. And then this is, I imagine, a bit of the North Acropolis, the outskirts of it. So you just get a sense of the scale of the site there from the castle. So I just wanted to draw out a few of these comparisons, really, between the diaries, which can be at times a little elliptical, but also quite stylized. And then the letters, where she obviously writes at greater length. So at sunrise, far away in the distance, on top of one of a group of low hills, I saw the castle of Palmyra, which is where she is here. We were still 5 hours away. They were long hours. The further we went, the further the hill retreated. As we drew near Palmyra, the hills were covered with the strangest buildings, great stone towers, 4 stories high, some more ruined and some less, standing together in groups or bordering the road. They are the famous Palmyrene tower tombs. At length, we stood on the end of the col and looked over Palmyra. I wonder if the wide world presents a more singular landscape. It is a mass of columns ranged into long avenues, grouped into temples, lying broken on the sand or pointing one long solitary finger to heaven. Beyond them is the immense Temple of Baal. The modern town is built inside it, and its rows of columns rise out of the mass of mud roofs. And beyond all is the desert, sand and white stretches of salt and sand again, with the dust clouds whirling over it and the Euphrates 5 days away. It looks like the white skeleton of town standing knee deep in the blown sand. One of the things I appreciate about this letter is we then go very much to the practical issues. So we have the net result of our journey is that we marched 27 hours out of 41 and that I'm looking forward to sleeping in a bed instead of a saddle and having a full complement of meals tomorrow. So you get a sense of some of Gertrude Bell's priorities there before she sets off into the ruins to take some of the earliest photography that we have of the site. So I'd like to say that this took me many days, but I thought it would be useful just to plot exactly where she was and what location she visited and took photos of in the 2 days that she was at the ruins. So we have a little bit off map, sadly, to the castle on the hill, as I like to call it. I think it's probably the easiest way of saying it. So that's where she visits that twice across the days that she's there. Otherwise, she as you can see, she very much interacts with a lot of the site during the time that she's there. She clearly has some priorities. The Temple of Bell is where many of the photos are taken naturally, because that's where the modern town is. And then we have the arch just outside. This is where she camps in the Temple of Bel Shemin, which we saw from a distance in that wider shot. And then otherwise, she spends quite a lot of time at the top of the colonnade in this kind of the more modern areas, the kind of later Roman period, Diocletian era, which is some of the better preserved ruins naturally, just because they're a bit newer. So she's got a lot of interest in that area of the city as well. So that just gives you a sense of kind of her itinerary in the ruins and what she got up to. This is again a view towards the Valley of the Tombs. So I think once we come off the hill, this would have been the kind of route down towards the ancient ruins that we've obviously seen from a greater distance, the white skeleton of the town she described. So these are the iconic tower tombs, now some of which are sadly destroyed owing to the Islamic State occupation a few years ago. This is the top of the colonnade with a bit of the Valley of the Tombs in again. I really just wanted to give you an overview of the quality of the photography that we have available to us now. And this is obviously Graham's work over the past year, longer. he's really been updating the quality that we have available to us. So I just wanted to give a kind of showcase of some of the images of Palmyra that we have. This is a view towards what was known as the sort of temple tomb, which was another type of funerary monument that the Palmyrene elite used. And then up to the castle, which has been restored today, but obviously you can see it kind of iconically situated there towards the northwest of the ancient ruins, and a little bit of colonnade there to the left of the shot. And there's a sort of wider bit of colonnade. Now, I'm pretty sure these could be some of her military troop. I'm just judging that off their tunics, but they don't look like Bedouin tribesmen to me. So I think they would have been her escort as she was traveling around, rummaging around the ruins. And then a little bit of colonnade there in the backdrop. So I think I can't really hear what they're called. This is where they camped. This is unusual in itself. So we've got a little bit of the tents themselves here. So this is unusual owing to the fact that many of the visitors to Palmyra would have been within the terminus of the Temple of Bel, which is where I'll come to as we move on in the talk. But Gertrude clearly decided that this was the place that she wanted to set up, and enabled her to get out amongst the colonnade very easily and into the ruins, and I guess just meant she had a bit of a less kind of cramped environment, as we'll come to the more densely populated Temple of Bel later. So we can see the tent over there to the right. And what I was like, is this the camera? No, it's a dog. I mean, the fact that we are in a photograph, so it's impossible. So this is the tower tombs. I have quite a long quotation from diaries that I'm probably, owing to time, not going to pull out right now. She sets off into the tower tombs with her two soldiers, who I think hopefully we've seen photographed, and she has a good route around the iconic tower tombs, but actually she only photographs one in particular, and I think this would have been because it's one of those that is picked up by a lot of the early texts on Palmyra, so she may have seen it in plates in other earlier texts from the 18th century and onwards. And then you just get the eye, really. She has a really good eye for kind of just the aesthetic quality of the photographs as well. It's a mixture of something that's a very valuable resource for us, owing to the fact that it's probably the first half dozen individuals to photograph Palmyra, but equally their works of art as well, which I think is something that we looked at with Valentina as well, with the flowers. It's a little bit text heavy, I'll give you a second to look at that, but we can see that we're back up on top of the hill, on top of the hill within the castle, which has been very much reconstructed in recent times, but was during the Syrian civil war occupied by troops loyal to Bashar al-Assad, so it's not had the best couple of years. The site as a whole, but also the castle and others of the tombs as well were used as military bases, and even the oasis itself was the site of some guerrilla warfare during the occupation of Tadmor, as the modern town is called. So that's her view from up on the hill that she returns to on day, I think it's the end of day two. And there's the arch, which I imagine if anyone's familiar with the site of Palmyra, it will be the arch which was reconstructed by the Institute of Digital Archaeology and paraded around Trafalgar Square. I'm sure you're more than welcome to ask my opinion on that. But yeah, we can see the castle in the background as well. So we've kind of got that reverse shot. So we're towards the Temple of Bel looking back on Palmyra here. Pardon, and I couldn't avoid that one. We have here the Temple of Bel just to the... Well, I'll be able to show you on this modern imagery. We're about here, I think. So to the right of the arch, looking in. I do apologise, that was just me photographing one of my supervisor's books, which seemed very useful. She talks at length about the natural beauty as well of Palmyra. So we've got sunset here ought to be numbered among the wonders of the world. The columns and temple walls turn yellow and then gold and then deep orange, and the desert behind flushes pink and fades away into a dim mystery in the dusk. So yeah, I mean, it just reads like a gothic novel to me, doesn't it? It's like something's going to happen now. And then she talks about how she's going to go off and discover more of the Temple of Bel. And this is how it looks. Well, not how it looks now, sadly. That is the fact that we only have the portal left after Islamic State's destruction of the monument. But back in 1900, when Bel was there, it was fully occupied and had been for almost a millennium. Now what I want to do is just explore Bel's visualization of the site and her version of Palmyra, because it's very different to what a modern tourist, if anyone had been there in the last 20 years or so, would have witnessed, because we have these mud brick houses that would have occupied a lot of the terminals. So we start with this kind of, and my reading of it is, we start with this kind of attempt to focus on the classical ruin at the expense of the local population and kind of try and really focalize on the monuments. So we have Ahmed, who's one of our soldiers, climbing up on the mud roofs. And I wanted to just get, this is the wife of a French archaeologist later, but I just thought it was a fun one, as we have, this is what going up on our step ladders would have looked like to explore within the terminus of the Temple of Bel. But back on the kind of main theme that I wanted to draw out, which was, we have this kind of attempt, so we can see the mud brick structures to the bottom here, which there's a lot of accounts of them from 19th century travellers who went there, and they're often quite, we'll use the euphemism, orientalized accounts of the local people and its effect on the classical ruin. So I think at this point there's that kind of state of flux between Bel wanting to very much focus on the classical ruin, as we can see within the precinct of the Temple of Bel, versus the modern town within the terminus. And we kind of see, then we see this kind of attempt to create something a little bit stylized. So I think this is called a howdah, which is what you use to ride a dromedary, basically. So that's what Bel would have rocked up to the ruins on. So we have this kind of, and I don't know, but I can't imagine you store it on your roof. So I feel like Bel could have gone up and kind of put it here to sort of get this sense of desert travel within the classical ruin. But we see these mud brick houses, that some of which are up to 3 or 4 stories high, beginning to kind of pop into those photographs. And this chap over here is just proof that we've got some, I don't know what he's up to, because obviously I'm not a photography expert, but you can see how people are beginning to kind of pop in. We get the sense of this inhabited space of the population of Palmyra almost reclaiming what is its own in the photographs of Bel. And I think you can either see it as this kind of conflict between a Western traveller wanting to focus on the Roman ruin versus, of course, what is at this point an occupied space by these previously Bedouin peoples that have permanently settled within the terminus. So this is the portico, the one bit that's actually still standing after the Islamic State. But the thing that I found interesting was, we see this kind of the people popping up more and more within the photographs. And then we get to the extent that we have just a family portrait of people that would have lived within this mud brick house within the terminus of the Temple of Bel. I think in terms of just the technology and the fact that she chooses to take this photo, she could have taken a photo of a ceiling or a fresco or whatever, but she chooses to take a photo of this family that lived within the ruins. And I think that's an interesting choice. And obviously it's a posed photo. It has certain parameters that needed to be in place at that time. So they have to stay still for a certain amount of time. And we've got all of these people involved. I think for me, it's very much sort of flip from those 19th century, very orientalized accounts, which basically trying to raise the local people and are very racist towards their presence in the ruins, versus Bel, which I think she gives quite a sympathetic portrait of people within Palmyra. So, because I know we're going to be running out of time a little bit, the French. The French arrive. So we've got this wonderful terminus of Temple of Bell with plenty of inhabitation. This is Robert Amy, this is Henri Sarig, who are two very famous French archaeologists from the Syrian Mandate. So post First World War, the French move in and take control of Lebanon and Syria, for better or for very much worse. So when it comes to the terminus of Temple of Bell, we see the clearance of the town that had lived there. So we see just how dense these temporary mud brick buildings, temporary, they've been there for nearly 1,000 years, were. So this is incredible, because obviously this is the rise of aerial photography as well. This isn't just a very tall person. So yeah, we can see how we're in the midst here. So this is probably 1929. So as Henri Sarig and Robert Amy are arriving and deciding what to do with the ruins, versus this is, well, this is really is depopulation and the erasure of that community that lived within the seminars. But you can see it in process. And this, I think, is another one of a contemporary photo here where we can see the rubble. And I don't think this is antique rubble. I think this is the remnants of those mud brick houses that we've seen. So you can see, again, this site and conflict between these periods. The French have come in, they've decided that they want to prioritize the classical ruin and obviously remove the population and move them into the new town, which I'm hoping is my next photo. No, it's not. But we get a sense of this is the site by the early 30s. So all of that population has been moved out, and there's also these suburbs around here, which I think have also been had their population removed, and obviously the oasis that we can see a little bit with its date palms around here. So you get the sense of just how quickly, you know, we're talking 1929 through to 1933 in these photographs, and they're all off into the new town. There's our castle from which Gertrude started her photographs. So this was very much in the period of, if you want to civilize populations, you need to build a Western style town and move from it. So yeah, I'm obviously presenting this in as objective a fashion as I can, but this was the idea that it's kind of urban ideals of this 1930s period. And to try and protect the classical ruin, this is why it's still standing, I imagine, because steel rods inserted into the portal protect the terminus, which had been a mosque during the Ottoman period. Obviously in antiquity was a pagan temple devoted to the sun. It becomes a tourist site, which is the iteration that we are most familiar with. Absolutely love this guy. He's my inspiration. Also like him, I mean, we've got some arty, possibly French tourists over here. But yeah, this is the iteration of the ruins that we're most familiar with. And then of course, that's what sadly happens to the site in 2015, owing to the Islamic State destruction. So all we're left with is the portal or lintel to the terminus. Everything else is flattened. So we've got this kind of double erasure now, which is we've now lost that Ottoman inhabited town, and now we've also lost that classical ruin that of course the French fought so hard to protect. So yes, this is our view of the Temple of Bell today, so taking us kind of full circle from how it would have looked in the 1900 when Bell arrived, through to early 1930s when Henri Sarig and Robert Amy were there, through to today's view. So yeah, lots of things to think about, potential reconstruction, what happens next, Russian influence, everyone loves Russian influence. Not sure what's going on here, I hope it's just oil. Lots of very important things in Tadmor, oil, airfields, lots of strategic importance in the site. So lots of futures for the site. I'm also aware I'm going on too long. So thank you for your attention. Those are three people that Bell photographed in 1900, obviously a very different site today. Things have changed and things are set to change again. Thank you for having me, Valentina, and thank you for your great photo. She goes back in 1925, which I also thought was quite funny, and she complains about hotel.
What format of photographs are they, glass plate or are they print?
These ones are, so these are from album A.
Sorry, Kate, are you okay with that?
Is that all right?
Yeah.
These ones are from album A, so they are in an album. But we also have, we have negatives for a number of them. I'm not sure if we, no, we must. So
it's just from the photo, the album A.
Yeah, we've got, yeah, so when there's a scans of the original nitrate negatives.
There we go.
So, yeah, so they're really unstable, which is why when 2 years ago we had in, and so the to do pilot projects in 2016 to see what would happen if we scanned them. And that came up pretty well. And it's sort of based on the best basis of that. And things from doing the basic scanning, everything that's available. It's about 7,000.
Yes.
And getting on to 8,000.
So Graham's been at it for about, I want to say, like, so he started for me, I started in August last year. So far I've been cataloguing the letters, not gone to the photographs yet, which is why I was quite vague about that, because I know that there are, but there's also just so many, like so many albums, so many negatives, and it all just depends on what ones we have and what ones we don't. So I think Graham's been at it for about 2 years now, is that right? Yeah. So like a long time, and he's now digitized all of the photographs. He has finished the diaries and he's now in the letters. So when it comes to the photographs, he is the expert at the moment, because I have not catalogued them yet. But yeah. So that is the earliest album and it is the most fragile. We don't get the physical albums out very often due to their fragility, but they are actually just about to go to a conservator, and they're gonna get the albums are gonna be conserved because they're beautiful, like the actual albums that she had, she's written the captions on them in her writing and pencil. They're very nice period pieces. They're very, very evocative. I'm very much, I do like an object, you know. I feel like it's that tangibility that really gives you a connection with an archive. And they're also going to get, they are obviously in archive boxes just now, but they're going to get their own bespoke boxes. So at the moment they're kind of padded with an archival tissue paper, but yeah, they're going to get the full treatment.
They're going to be fully photographed. Scanned before they
Graham's done that, yeah. So he's scanned the photographs as images, as like the ones you've just seen, but he's also digitized like the pages so that you can see them in context, and the front and the back covers. But conservation, as I kind of mentioned really briefly, is very like, so we had a conservator come and assess them. We got some of the worst ones out.
Which was
Alpine. Alpine, yeah. It's very brittle. Like if you touch the page too hard, the page will break. Like that really. Yeah, it's that kind of. It's like cardboard, but like thin, but also thick on the paper and really crumbly. But they, as a general conservators, try to be as non-interventive as. I don't know how. So basically, it's all about in preserving the integrity of the object. So she's going to do what she can to stabilize it, and also just. I don't know, make sure that all the things that we can put in place are in place. So making sure that there's the right paper, like silver safe, if it's a specific type of photograph, then if you put that on top, it will keep it kind of as preserved as it can be, although they do naturally degrade. Just that kind of sort of thing. And just make sure that we're doing the best thing that we can for them, because it's lovely getting them out, and it'd be nice to do that as much as we can without risking them.
But can I just say, I was surprised you would take out the staples or whatever she used.
The pins?
Yeah.
Well, I haven't, and no, I don't no, want
no,
to.
You said you had
yeah,
them
before, so well, generally.
It sounds good if they're not particularly degraded.
Yeah, so nettle degrades and it rusts, and I actually just went to, sorry Kate, I'll stop talking soon. No, it's fine, we are going to have questions at the end, but we're having a little bit of
questions at the end. Two questions at the end,
and I'm not in a rush, but obviously I didn't want you to have to
stay
if you need to go.
Yeah,
if anyone, loads of quotations I
should
read out.
So I just bought some little kind of Second World War pamphlets, very cheaply made, cheap paper, cheap metal, whatever, at a book fair at the weekend. And I took staples out myself because they're terrible, like they eat the paper. The paper becomes discoloured all round the metal rusts and the like rust flakes, and it's a whole mess. But hers are actually all right. Like, so I was like, oh, metal. So my instinct is take metal out. There's not a lot of metal in her stuff anyway, like, but it's just those things. They're actually pretty good. So I consulted with our conservator that we're getting in. I bought those entomological pins just in case there were any bad ones, and I could just swap it very carefully. But yeah, ordinarily you would take metal out if you saw it, like staples or whatever, in an archive, just because you know that the metal's not going to stay okay for a while. But hers are pretty stable, thankfully. So it's that balance between doing the best thing you can do to preserve the object and also preserving the authenticity and integrity of the object.
That's a nice step, I think.
Nice. Yeah, Kate, sorry.
I'm Kate Sweeney. I'm an artist. Oh, my label's not there. I apologise, but we couldn't hook my Mac laptop to this computer, so my photos are well out of order, so I'm going to be going quickly back and forth through, so you're going to get early views of pictures. but I'll just start talking. So I'm coming at this to Gertrude Bell's archive from quite a speculative, artistic, methodological approach to using archives. My PhD was in using video as a research tool within poetry archives and used conversation as a methodology. And this project itself, my project is called Home Colours. It came about through just a friendly conversation, informal conversation, should I say, with Ian Johnson, one of the archivists here, who was talking a little bit about his project to potentially colourise some of Gertrude Bell's photographs. And I said that my own research at the moment happened to be about making my own inks and dyes to paint my films with, using natural materials found within my immediate and intimate environment. And we ended up wondering out loud if there was a process of colourising the photographs of Gertrude Bell this is what I was talking about, that would be a more discursive, potentially culturally inclusive, an open, creative one, that rather than just sort of using purchase colours and dyes to paint the images. And I just got kind of taken up with this idea that there might be a way to do that. But before doing any of that, I did a small, very small research project, just looking at what was actually in the archive and where I might start. And Ian introduced me to Valentina for this. So this idea of conversation, it is quite open but reflexive. So the idea is that you allow yourself to use guesswork, hunches, speculation, coincidence, randomness, and maybe even mistakes as part of the methodology. All the kinds of things that I think make archivists faint on the floor with fear and horror. And sometimes there is an abrasive relationship that can, or at least the abrasive situational conversations about how to approach something. But often I think it can produce interesting and exciting results that open up conversations, like more conversations. So after initially meeting Valentina, we visited the collection to look at the diaries, and Valentina had laid out what she thought me as an artist would be interested in looking at, and it was the photo books of all the photographs from the Middle East. But funnily enough, we did end up mainly talking about and looking at the flowers that were pressed inside Gertrude's diaries. And I think one of the reasons that this caught my eye, bearing in mind I knew virtually nothing really about Gertrude Bell. They might move of their own color. So I didn't really know anything about these archives, so I was just allowing myself to be drawn to some things that seemed to relate maybe to what I was interested in my work. And we talked about this idea of this photograph or this collection of flowers and feathers with the title Taj next to it being a sort of portrait of the place that Gertrude Bell had gone. And I think in a little bit in the way that she writes as well, that's quite a modernist, you think of Virginia Woolf, there's actually quite a fractured way of approaching a literary titling, which is just to take a very small thing and allow its essence, if you like, to illustrate or tell its own story without a massive amount of other details, sort of abstraction, if you like. And this for me resonated with my own home project, using dyes and colours to paint images about my own life from my immediate surroundings. So rather than going into the photographs from the Middle East, I decided I would quite like to look through two boxes of personalia from Gertrude Bell, which included photographs taken in and around Gertrude's homes in Britain, including Red Barns in Redcar, and we opened up these boxes with a kind of, I've written this here, so I'm just going to say, with a sort of lightness maybe more associated through rummaging through miscellanea in the backs of antique stores rather than a sort of archivist's approach, and just came across two loosely labelled images of what, as Valentina would have said, we didn't definitely know were Gertrude's rooms in Red Barns, but I kind of just enjoyed the image itself and decided that this was the line of inquiry that I was going to take, partly because I felt like they must have a significance, and then we spent some time sort of looking into it, and I think we did discover, didn't we, that they are
one of them, rooms. There's several copies, one copy was labelled on that scene of Gertrude's
bedroom. That's right, yeah, so there were many copies of the image, and I think we were told as well, but whilst we were doing this research, I sort of drifted off into looking at other things, and this is just a slight aside, but I wanted to know about the killings. And they're the cloths that align on the chairs in the images. And I did my own very rough Google translate of some of the text that's written on the killings themselves. I got many translations, this is my favourite. It's not difficult for me to please you. Another one was about being headhunted. I put this in as an example of doing research from a material-based research from a distance, because I was also looking at what materials and what dyes would have been used to dye the killings, and it would have been madder and indigo, and at that time probably bought from Turkey and shipped to all over the Middle East to be used. So it was already a sort of industrialized process. It wouldn't have been a home handmade process. And I sort of thought all of that feels like it would be an area that would be great to open up a dialogue with universities, artists, researchers in that area, looking at how we maybe use colours and dyes sourced through kind of a more authentic conversation rather than Googling things. So we went to Red Barns and decided that I would collect the materials that I would use to dye, try to colourise these images from the site itself. That's me looking and over the bar team talk. When we were there, we happened to be there on a day that the final bit of the building was being converted to flats. And there was a builder there and he let us in. And this is one of the coincidental sort of random things. Quite nice, and he was giving us his bits of information that he had, but he didn't think that this would have been where the Bells lived. That had already been converted. This was probably a barn, or maybe first staff quarters, then animals, an animal barn, and then a pub. And then that's from behind. That's as we visited, he let us in just to have a look round, and so we photographed and collected some of this sort of stratigraph, if you like, of the layers of evidence, I suppose, of inhabitants and activity, but not going back to anything tangible from that period. But I loved it, so I collected a lot of this material I brought in, and just decided that even though this was seen like ruins, it just felt quite significant to me. So there was little bits of clay pots from the garden, all miscellany, wallpaper from the 80s, wallpaper with, well, weirdly enough, this wallpaper has animal hair in the plaster. So connotative, if not definite, wood, bird shells. And then in this fireplace, this is outside in the chimney, there was I dug very far down and took what I like to speculate would have been very old charcoal from probably not that old, but still, and brought all that stuff home. And I made So first I took the photographs that we'd taken and I sort of overlaid them, just I suppose in a sort of poetic kind of idea about time and transition and the way that buildings change. It's not an accurate, obviously, site, but it just feels like it relates to this idea of a constantly shifting site, really. And then with the materials that I collected, I made these dies. I've actually just brought them in rather than. So there was daffodils growing on the site. That's a daffodil die. That's grass. This is brick dust from what I think is probably quite original bricks. Just from the edge, the builder was giving us bits from that. That's the coal die that I was telling you about. And from that, I just painted a couple of images of red barns using the dies themselves. Again, a kind of whimsical, I suppose, but just doing it to kind of keep going with this idea of materialism. I actually thought we were going to do a round table today, so it was going to be easy to just spread these around.
Yeah, okay. There was a round table.
Well, it doesn't matter. I'm just there, my friend. Yeah, and I tried a little bit with the dies to paint the pictures, but I haven't had time properly to do it on the right paper, and they basically didn't come out very well. So you can have a look at them if you like. But this is dandelion. This is dandelion ink. Just the whole paper dyed in it. So it has a kind of resonance. But actually, I think it will be possible because these are quite. They did actually come out quite well to paint the photographs, but maybe not these photographs because it's quite dark. There's a lot of thinking to be done. My vision would be lovely, I think, to communicate with, like I said, with students, universities in places nearby the photographs that Rory was showing, and maybe gather some of these materials, use them to colorize the photographs and have conversations, I think, on some of the things that Rory touched on, about provenance, about the nature of authenticity, the nature of colour even in photography. And in a way, the objects that come out, these sort of art pieces, are useful, but they're sort of, for me, they're more conversational and process-driven tools to allow that kind of openness to happen. And it can be indirect as well. So in a way, it's arbitrary or kind of random nature means that you can allow, I think, for lots of opinions and lots of points of entry. You don't have to be an expert in your own region or anyone else's to pound up a load of brick and turn it into colour. You don't actually need massive amount of skill either, but it does give you something to do while you talk about ideas. So that's the talk, but I just wanted to do a post-it because some of my research ended up being about archives and social media, and this idea of the digital being random rather than pattern based. And I put my paintings on Instagram. And a really good friend of mine said that he really liked it. And then when he realized what it was, he realized that his cousin had bought Red Barns and it was her who lived there. And so he sent her, you can see it in this. It's not in this photo. Oh yeah, he has Jackie and the top one, yeah. So he linked Jackie, his cousin, into the photographs. She wants one of these paintings now, which is fine. But also, she's also up for conversation about the work that they did, trying to preserve aspects of the house itself.
It still looks quite authentic from outside, doesn't it?
It does. They really tried to do some things with that, yeah. And then I think with other things. It was funny because this is the thing about distance, I think. People are welcome to look around, yeah.
Well, anyone can see it on there as well.
It was quite interesting because that thing of distance, and the thing that maybe social media and conversation does, is it reminds you that these are real people you're talking about. And this sounds awful to admit, but I very nearly wrote something slightly cutting about a beautiful, historically significant building being converted into flats. And I'm so glad that I didn't, because it would have been so rude to my friend. And I think that what conversational driven research does is that it reminds you sometimes that proximity to things can feel distant until people are involved, and then you feel really close. And so how one navigates conversationally can actually, I think, lead to new ways of, I suppose, communicating in ways that, that suits everybody, because conversation is not formal, so you can make mistakes. You can't make mistakes on instruments. You have to remember it's published, you know, it's a published platform. So you have to be really careful. It really reminded me of that. And this is now a published transcript, even if it feels really sort of friendly and a bit mad. Joseph and I talked for about 2 hours afterward, and his cousin, I think his cousin was quite flustered and overwhelmed. And that photograph of me looking at him in the windows feels really uncomfortable now. Just lots of layers, a bit like mirroring the bell, but not. But there's enough connotation, I think, of somebody turning up and having their own, like, souvenir-driven desire to collect things, a bit like the Japanese sticker that hadn't been labelled because it really was a souvenir, which is also, you can argue, a sort of modernist. Why modernism is a fractured take on things, because it's actually about people gathering material indicators of their own days out. You know, a lot of Virginia Woolf's writing has a touch of that. And I think maybe Bell was doing that, and we all do it where we collect things, and we're not necessarily thinking of its provenance, we're thinking more of how it reminds us of a nice day. And again, that's about proximity. That's it. That's my little talk. I don't know how necessarily relevant it is, but I feel like there was a connotation between the three.
And we can just take any questions.
Yeah.
Just so that people can see it, so if anyone sees the recording.
Sorry, yeah, you can see that I've been
able, oh, are we on this?
You see that I've been in hybrid lectures, so I'm used to people needing to see people.
I forgot to say that we're recording this.
But only us, no one.
But only us, like this way. Also, if anyone is uncomfortable, we can cut you out. Although we can't see you and no one's really said much. But I should have said that to begin, and that's my fault, sorry. This feels very formal now. Has anyone got any questions?
That's all right, I can back off then. Let's look around.
We've got one for Rory. Those two aerial photos, where did they come from? Are they part
of
the archive as well?
So the one that I know, they're not anything to do with Gertrude. So the famous one is a man called Antoine Roidebar. Yeah. Try and get a Roidebar. I don't think they're his though, because he's a little bit earlier. So I'm not entirely sure. I imagine the French sent someone up. I can get it's. I just, to be honest, I shamelessly stole them from Research Games, so I will attribute them in time. Sorry, everyone. I'm not entirely sure, but yeah, they were taken. And the reason they're obviously of such interest is because you can see that clearance in process, so you can get a genuine date for them. But yeah, aside from the fact that it maybe someone in military intelligence, I don't know. I haven't got exact name.
Interesting to know how many sort of big monumental sort of sites like that had the central, you know, had those settlements, existing settlements inside the site that were then removed. I mean, thinking of a couple of places in Libya, like Cyrenaica, the Italian archaeologists moved the whole town and built lots of sort of ornamental trees around it, and which are now damaging the site because it's sort of grown bigger. It'd be interesting to know, you know, how many places.
I think
many places in Syria have that.
It's just on that scale, because I was thinking, like, one that I know, for instance, is Tripoli. Like, the Roman arch was used as a shop and a theatre and all sorts of different purposes. But I think with Palmyra, it's just the sheer scale of it. Like, I mean, one estimate was about 1,000 people or more living within that small space of the terminal. Well, relatively small space of the terminal. I was thinking about Hatra. I was looking at the other day. I don't know if Hatra had a population within the actual
temple. That could be an interesting
temple,
project,
but,
isn't it?
That's sort of...
So look at that, how many sites sort of, and then how many cases of the archaeologists going in and kind of...
Yes, especially in that period, it's post-antiquity. There are some books that look at it. I don't know if they necessarily look at it sort of like a sort of urban space, but yeah, it's a really interesting period, especially when, you know, the mandates come in.
Any other questions?
Yeah. I love the, all of it actually, I love the way, I remember years ago seeing the press flowers, and thinking, you know, how sad it was that that's not captured. And I think what both Valentina and Kate were into was show how once they are scanned, or now that they're scanned, once they're available on the internet, it's going to just create so many more possibilities for people to have research, which might be quite literal, like, is this a puppy?
Yes.
To right through to, you know, really
quite
kind of imaginative, and no one else would ever have thought of doing with this kind of.
I think like those dyes, that's so cool. So
yeah, the dyes is brilliant.
And yes, I'm sure you could do that in, you know, with materials in Iraq. I mean.
Yeah, so that's what we were talking about.
Well, I think OSL samples, but some random stuff.
It just, for me, that feels like it creates that random idea when you're making something like that. It is the time when you have the time, whether you're an Iraqi student of languages, anything, maths, say, but you're involved in a workshop. As you're doing something like that, you slowly begin to think of where it resonates within your own life. And I think that is sort of mirror of a way that the internet works or digital works that is quite human. As much as it was one of the reasons why it feels so fearsome and overwhelming, social media and things, because it actually, for me, fits very quickly into a mode that we all operate in, which is actually we've been concentrating as a research species, if you like, as a humans, on pattern and how we work with pattern. But since the sort of emergence of digital, there's much more of an awareness of how we work connotatively, but also impulsively and randomly. And that idea of being able to put objects that before didn't have, that weren't necessarily looked at, having the ability to allow them this random life, feels a little bit out of control, but that and threatening possibly, I think, to certain research traditions. But then what do you do about that? I think you can either try to cloak it and stop it, which I don't think is a good idea, or you can kind of embrace it. But in a way, I think that's where these possibly rooted in the arts is research and visual cultures is where these start to become relationships that can be nurtured in the university.
But I think it's interesting because obviously like the creative outlet is that random element, but then you've also got the direct and tangible links to the site itself.
Yeah, exactly. And that's where you need both kind of both research disciplines, I think, because you know, there were lots of times when we were talking, and this was a tiny research project really, but lots of times when we were talking, it really was important to have both sort of disciplines, I think, otherwise you'd just drift off into, you know. I could just be doing anything really, and you have to keep it slightly sort of squared around and kited around something, I think.
Well, making that presentation reminded me of our conversation, like my presentation, because I remember when you were looking at that photo and we didn't know, there's like the personalia is like a little bit complicated in terms of its provenance and stuff like that. It's not part of the main Bell kind of corpus, but it's stuff that relates to her and that has been given by different people. And there's a couple of prints of that photo of her bedroom, and the one that we were looking at in that moment didn't have anything on the back or anything like that to see what it was. And you were like, oh, I think it's her bedroom. Imagine it was like, it feels like it could be her bedroom. And we were going off in a conversation, and I was like, yeah, but like, what if it's not? Like, what if we do this big thing and it's not her bedroom? And you were like, yeah, it's okay.
Great.
And so when I was doing that presentation, I was trying to work out what the flowers were, where the places are, what the bird was. And I was saying to Rory, like, what if people look at that and they go, oh, well, that can't be there because she couldn't have got there in that time. And he was like, but it's okay. Yeah. And it doesn't have to be a concrete thing. Like, it could not be that bird, but it could be that bird. Do you know, it's that kind of like, I don't know, it's more of an experience researching it rather than coming to a finite conclusion. And when you are cataloguing, you are recording the facts and you're not making assumptions that you don't know about, obviously, because then you would be just spreading misinformation. So that's a thing. But there is such possibility for creative responses and emotional responses to archives. And I think maybe people don't realise that they can do that and that they can just come and look at it, not in order to write a PhD, sorry, no offense, sorry, but because you want to make art or because you want, do you know what I mean? I mean, I have so much that I could wax lyrical about archives all day, but the reason that I mentioned in my talk that I didn't have much Bell knowledge before I started, other than the main points, was that I feel like it's given me quite a unique view of her as like a human, because I know that she's problematic, I know that she's nuanced, I know that she did amazing work in terms of what she captured, that's an invaluable resource, but I also know that she's a product of her time, that she held views that I don't agree with, that she was involved in things that had really bad long-lasting ramifications for the Middle East. But I've also seen letters where she talks to her her sister, and she says, I'm so lucky, I don't know word for word, but she says, I'm so lucky to have a sister because we have this relationship and it's such a special bond that we, she basically says how glad she is to have her as a correspondent and how she feels that she's missed out on seeing her nieces and nephews grow up because of what she's been doing. And there was a little bit of her clearly thinking that she's, you know, she's quite grandiose because she says, well, one can't be a dedicated aunt and also guide an oriental monarch with the other hand, something like that. Like, and these letters aren't transcribed, but they are going to be digitized and available online. And she says something in the letter to her sister, so one can't be a dedicated aunt on one hand and guide an oriental monarch on the other. So she's like, oh, I've made the sacrifice. But that's a really personal thing that she says, and that makes you see her not just as a professional, an archaeologist, a diplomat, a socialite, whatever, just as a human being that has these relationships. And that's something that I think that you get as an archivist. You don't need, like Kate was saying but before, like, you don't necessarily need to be an expert in that field. You need to know how to archive, how to catalogue. That's what you need to know. And then you learn, and then you observe, and you soak it up. And yeah, I think it's quite a unique point of view, because I'm not coming to it with any preconceived notion of, I think she's great, I think she's bad, I think we should talk about her, I think we should talk about her work, we should talk about the implications of that, and that's okay, because it's valuable. So yeah, sorry, I could go on for ages.
One of the things I wanted to ask, or comment on, when Rory was talking, I love the way that, because it doesn't happen, it only really happens when we have talks, or when we have the exhibition. So when brought together photographs, the things that she'd written, sometimes the objects she's brought back, and you see them together, and they're sort of brought back for the first time to where they once were, you know, 100 years ago. And just you reading about photographs, which, you know, reading what she'd written at the same place as the photographs, which I mean, I've done, but when I'm doing it, I'm not listening to someone do it. I really like listening to you do it. And I thought one of the things.
There's more of it, I should the hour I needed.
But it really comes to life. And I think one of the things we need to ensure with a new website is that you can have both, not just either or. And I think the other thing that would be really nice is to have both with modern people's comments as well, because the kind of thing that, you know, Kate, you're doing is showing that it's not just the archive, it's also all the other things that were brought to it. And I think that sort of layering is really interesting, and the way that those different sources complement one another.
I also think it's more genuine to Gertrude as well, because there is that sort of experiential nature of her travel. Like, we've seen the flower presses, we've seen the descriptions. Like, yes, she's an archaeologist, she obviously inherits the sort of academic elements that we talk about and derive. But she's both of those worlds. Like, she's at once that sort of experiential traveller and that cataloguer of sites and researcher. So I think, yeah, it's finding a way.
And that, I didn't like go into like archives and cataloguing and whatever else, but that is a really important element of it, is having the, I don't know what the word is, like, you're seeing it as a piece of archive. It is an archive. I mean, you structure it catalogue wise however you want and however you feel is appropriate. I mean, there's whole books and essays and whatever that have been written about how you should structure an archive, but basically you don't put things into silos, you let them talk to each other. And you say, like, so she and her archive is like such a good example of this, because she says in her letter, oh, mother, thanks for sending me this book, I read it on the boat. And like, we could have that book. Like, I have not, the book collection that we have is like a whole other thing. So that's not included in the remit of the archives project, because we're concentrating on the archive. But the books in the archive, although in cultural heritage, you do tend to split them up, because rare books catalogue and archives catalogue are different. They talk to each other. She not only talks about them, but she writes in her books. There's annotations in the books. There's notes that have been historically removed from the books and put with the archive, but they are part of the book. So I don't know what the answer is in terms of, do you keep the notes with the books or not? But no matter what you do physically, you should always maintain that link, so that you can say, this was from this book here, and then you can view it in context. Because we've had it for so long, it's been through a lot of hands. Everyone who has dealt with it has tried to do what they feel is the best thing to do. And equally, like, archivists, it's not like a really old profession, it evolves all the time. People, you know, decide, same with conservation as well, people realize that one way is better than another way, and then you evolve your practice. But basically, yes, when we catalogue the archive, these links will be made in terms of the presentation on the website, we're creating a new website, I didn't mention that. That is something that we'll work out with the web designer, but a fundamental part of cataloguing is having access points. So she mentions that she met, I don't know, whoever it is, they will be listed as an authority. So like they'll have an authority file, so you'll click them and it'll tell you who they are, and you'll see all the other mentions of them, all the other representations. Equally, I'll be able to say, and I definitely will, because this occurs all the time, I'll be able to say in this letter that, like, this is this diary entry that this corresponds with, or that she mentions this event, and this is also represented here. And it's pulling that all out because it provides context, but it also helps you explore the collection in a way that makes sense. And at the moment, the diaries are the diaries, and the letters are the letters, and the photographs are the photographs. Mm-hmm. And although they are staying, like, in that sense, like, they are grouped according to what they are not totally separate. They all feed into each other. And it also helps you understand them. If you don't know where she was when she took this photograph, you look at the date and you look at her diaries, or you look at her letters.
Also, it's the Gertrude Bell armband. Like, it's a highly personalised thing. It's not a catalogue to search. Mm-hmm. I mean, obviously it needs to have those tools, but it also needs to understand that we're seeing it through someone's eyes and someone's mind in a specific mm-hmm. period. So yeah, ways to link those up. And again, I'm not a website designer. Possibly.
I was going to ask,